Good morning, and welcome to morning prayer for the third Sunday after Pentecost. We're starting morning prayer just a little bit differently this morning with the confession, so you are invited to join me on page 78 in your Book of Common Prayer or in the virtual bulletin. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia. The earth is the Lord's, for he made it. Come, let us adore him.
Be joyful in the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song. Know this, the Lord himself is God. He himself has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and call upon his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his faithfulness endures from age to age.
Surely for your sake I have suffered reproach, and shame has covered my face. I have become a stranger to my own kindred, an alien to my mother's children. Zeal for your house has eaten me up. The scorn of those who scorn you has fallen upon me. I humbled myself with fasting, but that was turned to my reproach. I put on sackcloth also, and became a byword among them. Those who sit at the gate murmur against me, and the drunkards make songs about me. But as for me, this is my prayer to you at the time you have set, O Lord. In your great mercy, O God, answer me with your unfailing help. Save me from the mire, do not let me sink. Let me be rescued from those who hate me, and out of the deep waters. Let not the torrents of water wash over me, neither let the deep swallow me up. Do not let the pit shut its mouth upon me. Answer me, O Lord, for your love is kind. In your great compassion, turn to me. Hide not your face, your servant. Be swift and answer me, for I am in distress. Draw too near to me, and redeem me, because of my enemies, deliver me.
A reading from Genesis. The child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, who she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you, Do as she tells you, for it is through Isaac that the offspring will be named for you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring. So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba on Mount Sinai. When the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot. For she said, "Do not let me look on the death of a child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up, and he lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. This is the word of the Lord.
Canticle today is taken from the third song of Isaiah. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has dawned upon you. For behold, darkness covers the land, deep gloom enshrouds the peoples, but over you the Lord will rise, and his glory will appear upon you. Nations will stream to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawning. Your gates will always be open. By day or night, they will never be shut. They will call you the city of the Lord, the Zion of the Holy One of Israel. Violence will no more be heard in your land, ruin or destruction within your borders. You will call your walls salvation, and all your portals praise. The sun will no more be your light by day. By night you will not need the brightness of the moon. The Lord will be your everlasting light, and your God will be your glory. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
A reading from the Gospel according to Matthew. A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher, and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I will also deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to this earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. The word of the Lord. In the name of our loving and liberating and life-giving God, amen. You know that one of the things I love most about church is singing and our hymnody. And the hymn that's been going through my head this whole week is hymn number 675, Take Up Your Cross. And the words go like this. Take up your cross, the Savior said, if you would my disciple be. Take up your cross with willing heart and humbly follow after me. Take up your cross, let not its weight fill your weak spirit with alarm. His strength shall bear your spirit up and brace your heart and nerve your arm. The words of that hymn definitely correspond with this week's gospel from Matthew, at least in my estimation. Because one of the things that that hymn talks about that is also talked about in our gospel is fear. Fear is one of the most pervasive and powerfully motivating forces in the human experience. From the moment that we are born, we learn to fear things about the world around us. I'm sure that that's a survival instinct from long ago. Certainly we learn to fear the stranger. Sometimes we even learn to fear those who are closest to us. Political leaders have long recognized the power of fear in ensuring our conformity to the structures of the world. And even when doing so does not serve our best interests. Fear is a driving force behind vast segments of our economy, as well as increasingly our political priorities. Jesus recognizes that fear will also cause the failure of discipleship. Jesus' disciples courageously leave the security of their homes and families to follow Jesus as they proclaim the coming of God's kingdom. But they too will know and ultimately bow down before the power of fear. Faithful proclamation and practice of the gospel inevitably puts disciples and us on a collision course with the powers and rulers of this world. So as Jesus prepares his disciples for their mission to the lost sheep of Israel, he is starkly realistic about the threats that they will face. And at the same time, Jesus builds the case for why they should not let this fear master them or hinder their witness. Do not be afraid, he says. Jesus's missional discourse is a get out the volunteers campaign by no other, like no other. On the one hand, the disciples are granted remarkable powers to do remarkable things in Jesus's name, exorcise demons, cleanse lepers, even raising the dead. But Jesus also denies them money, pay, extra clothes, a staff for protection, even sandals. They are to undertake their mission in complete vulnerability and in complete dependence on God. Even knowing that they go as sheep in the midst of wolves, to face arrests and beatings, opposition even from family members, and hatred and persecution, Jesus urges his disciples to go on anyway. Why does Jesus highlight the powers and the horrors that await the disciples? Because naming aloud the suffering to be endured and its causes is the first step in freeing them from that grip of fear. And it's the first step for us too. In the latter half of this discourse, where our focus lies, Jesus continues to describe the worst case scenarios, wound together with statements of reassurance and repeated calls to resist fear. Those calls echo to us today. The most important element of reassurance lies in the integral relationship that is affirmed between the disciples and Jesus, and through Jesus, God. Do not fear is the dominant recurring message of Jesus's story and missional proclamation. But first he offers a word of warning. Whatever fate awaits teachers or masters also awaits their disciples and slaves. If Israel's elites called Jesus the Prince of Demons, the disciples should be ready for a similar response. But again, Jesus says, have no fear of them. The claim that whatever is covered up will be uncovered and that secrets will be made known arises from the disclosive power of the gospel, the uncovering power of the gospel to shed light on truth. The disciples participate in this power of the gospel through the means of their mission in the world. Their simplicity, vulnerability, and dependence on God demonstrate the reality of God's presence and character in the fate of the world's claims to possess the real power. Even though doing so will bring suffering, the gospel must now be proclaimed in the light and from the housetops, for the gospel proclaimed and lived is the most powerful tool that the disciples and we have at our disposal against the rulers and powers of this world. The threat of death may be the most powerful form of fear, yet Jesus's next expression of reassurance addresses that fear directly and with some irony. The right to kill is one of the chief props in the facade of human power. Jesus admits that humans exercise this power, but notes that they have power only to kill the body, not the whole person. God alone can destroy both body and soul, but God alone can also protect those things. And God alone, then, is the one we should fear. This claim represents God's power as surpassing, but similar in kind to that of human rulers. But Jesus makes sure to reassure the disciples that God is not, in fact, like the powers and rulers of this world. God knows and cares even for the sparrows who are sold two for a penny. God knows even the hairs on our heads better than we do. The threat of violence and death are real concerns for the disciples, but no longer the determining force in their lives. For the one who has ultimate power over our whole being exercises that power with mercy and love. The disciples know that in their mission, they are held in God's love and care. The sayings in Matthew 10:32-39 encourage disciples to remain firm in their commitment to Jesus and their mission, even when the mission generates inevitable conflicts, even within their families. The saying in verse 34 is crucial. Although Jesus has called his disciples to be peacemakers, his mission does not bring peace, but a sword. So long as the powers resist God's rule and will, the very act of peacemaking, as Jesus' ministry demonstrates, will generate violence in some situations. Violence that then leads to healing, restoration, and the conquest of death threaten the foundations of all human assertions of power in defiance to God. Finally, the call to discipleship renders secondary all other claims upon one's identity and allegiance, even to father or mother or son or brother. This doesn't mean that we don't love our fathers or mothers or sons or brothers, but just that our allegiance lies first with God. To take up the cross aligns the disciples and us and their mission and fate with that of Jesus, that is, with the humiliation, suffering, shame, opposition, and death that Jesus persistently speaks about. It also aligns us and the disciples with those who suffer those things in the world around us. To take up the cross implies identification with the marginalized people, with slaves and rebels, with those for whom society has said don't matter. Those in Jesus' time were subject to Roman crucifixion because they did not align themselves or submit to Rome's authority. So taking up the cross literally would be taking up a symbol of death. But Jesus promises that those who lose their life for Jesus' sake will in fact find it, and those who find their lives in this world will lose it. The answers to fear, then, include clear-eyed recognition of the facades of human power, even those rooted in the threat of death. It involves awareness of the conflict and division the gospel inevitably produces, and it gives us an especially deep awareness and conviction that God is present in the world in the form of mercy and compassion. The answers to fear, then, are to not fear. So let us not fear, but to take up our crosses. And again, as that old hymn says, take up your cross and follow Christ, nor think till death to lay it down. For those who bear the cross may hope to wear the glorious crown. Peace be with you, friends, and do not be afraid. Take care. Please join me in saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This Sunday for the suffrages, I invite you to read along with me. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Let your people sing with joy. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Lord, keep this nation under your care and guide us in the way of justice and truth. Let your way be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
The Collect for the Third Sunday After Pentecost. O Lord, make us have perpetual love and reverence for your holy name, for you never fail to help and govern those whom you have set upon the sure foundation of your loving kindness. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. A Collect for Sundays. O God, you make us glad in the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessing through our worship of you that the week to come may be spent in your favor. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now, a collect for the mission of the Church. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
At this time, I invite your prayers of intercession or thanksgiving, either silently or aloud. O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name, bring offerings and come into his courts. Good morning again, and welcome on this third Sunday after Pentecost and this Father's Day Sunday. We hope that however you are celebrating this day with the fathers or the people who have been like fathers to you, or remembering your fathers who are no longer with you, we hope that today is a blessed day for each of you. Just a few announcements for the good of the community. First is that Wednesday night programs and Wednesday programs on Facebook Live continue this week, so you can check your email and your bulletin for all of that information. Second of all, Vacation Bible School is coming up soon, and the premiere week is not to be missed. So if you know any young people who want to participate, please do make sure that you've signed them up. Missy and a bunch of other folks who have been working really hard, and it's going to be a wonderful week. Also, in light of the things that have gone on in our cities over the last few weeks after the death of George Floyd, many of us have asked what we can do to make some sort of difference. Well, this coming weekend, the Outreach Committee is sponsoring a Stuff the Truck event to benefit Veep, one of our partners in the community, and they have a very specific list of items that they need for donation. So if you would like to help stuff the truck and make a difference, not only for Veep, but for those who are recipients of all of those items, please do check your virtual bulletin and the emails this week for detailed instructions about not only what they need for donations, but also how it will work when you come to drop off the items that you want to donate, so that we also take care and are mindful of one another in light of COVID-19. So that'll be a great way to make a small difference in our community. Finally, we hope that you can join us for a special Father's Day live piece at 11 o'clock. We will be wishing one another peace, as well as wishing a happy Father's Day to all of us who are gathered there. So please join us at 11 o'clock on the live piece. Again, it's great to be with you, and I hope that wherever you are, you have a blessed Sunday, a blessed Father's Day, and a wonderful week. Please join me in saying our closing prayer, the prayer of St. Chrysostom, together. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time, with one accord, to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
May the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. See you at the live piece.